are learning to organize and govern themselves by reinventing indigenous cultures and processes. Although they refuse to accept government aid and intervention, they are not separatists. Instead, they focus on building a grassroots and bottom-up framework for government from below, rooted in local assemblies, autonomous municipalities, regional political centers known as caracoles, and good government councils that regularly meet to make decisions based on people's need and participation. The guiding political ethical principle in autonomous territories is mandar obedeciendo, lead by obeying, which ensures that political leaders act as public service providers working for the common good rather than as self-centered politicians promoting their own ambitions. So the local leaders of the Zapatistas accept positions on a rotating basis. They don't campaign for the offices, they receive no salary, and they can be recalled at any time. And finally, the Zapatista territories are committed to transforming the reproduction of everyday life through social autonomy. They are taking the construction of social institutions into their own hands. Rebel municipalities have built their own hospitals and clinics for health while training hundreds of doctors and health promoters to serve people's physical needs. They have also created an alternative educational network with hundreds of new schools and educational promoters, and even an autonomous university center. In this process, they are learning to make other social worlds possible by shaping their own bodies, minds, and subjectivities. Yet, despite impressive growth in self-governance, self-reliance, and self-organizing, it is important to emphasize that this autonomy is a flawed, experimental, and open-ended process, with many ups and downs rather than a finished achievement. Struggle for autonomy occur as much within the violent capitalist and state system as against and beyond it. Nevertheless, it's clear that the Zapatista movements, a strategy since 2004, has done more to enhance material, political, and social dignity in the poorest indigenous communities of Chiapas than any violent or non-violent strategy of the world ever did. This autonomy project is not just dealing with the external relationships of the Zapatista communities with the Mexican state and the capitalist market, but also internally in their own relations. So we are also claiming that revolutionary Zapatista women engaged in various forms of counter-conduct to critique and enhance the Zapatista struggles for autonomy within their own communities. As I have mentioned, the struggles for autonomy necessarily take place within, as well as against and beyond the existing system. But as a result of struggling within, you always face the danger of reproducing direct structural, psychological, and routine violence associated with the state and capitalism within your own communities. So although the Zapatista movement's struggles for autonomy have allowed participants to organize their own communities, they have also perpetuated sexual domination and violence suffered by many Zapatista women. Here, we think we can draw on Michel Foucault's concept of counterconduct. It's useful for understanding the Zapatista women's resistance to abusive relations of power and ways of governing conduct. Foucault, in his book Security, Territory, and Population, redefines government by linking how individuals are governed by others to how they govern themselves. In other words, government consists of the conduct of conduct. by political authorities and discourses through the state and the law, as well as by the ethical relations of the self with the self in everyday life. So to go beyond conventional notions of resistance, Foucault introduces the term counterconduct that depicts struggles highlighting how individuals and collectives conduct themselves, are being conducted, and conduct others. These struggles are specific revolts of conduct aimed at wanting to be conducted differently by other leaders towards other objectives and forms of salvation, and through other procedures or methods. Counterconduct is not about not being governed at all, but about the art of not being governed like that, and at that cost. The art of not being governed quite so much. Revolutionary Zapatista women have responded to direct structural, psychological, and routine forms of internal patriarchal violence within the Zapatista movement by engaging in the kind of counterconduct that Foucault had in mind. As the activist ethnographer Hilary Klein describes in her book, Compañeras, Zapatista Women's Stories, the colonial capitalist system's impact on indigenous subjects is violent and totalizing, affecting social relationships in public as well as in private life. While Zapatista women bear the brunt of these oppressive and destructive forces, they are also at the forefront of struggles for dignified, autonomous, and nonviolent ways of life. Before 1994, indigenous women had almost no control over their own lives, families, and local communities. They usually had to marry against their will, give birth to an average of 7 or more children, and face a constant threat of rape while lacking contraception and reproductive rights. They often suffered from domestic abuse due to alcoholism and could not leave the house without permission from their fathers or husbands. But with the emergence of the Zapatista movement, that encouraged female militants to actively refuse such violent gender relations. Female combatants who joined the Zapatista army in the early 1980s learned that they were no less capable of organizational leadership and courageous battle than their male compañeros. The most dramatic example of counterconduct by compañeras is the Revolutionary Women's Law adopted in 1993. After years of organizing indigenous people in Chiapas, Zapatista women began creating a legal framework to guide their revolt of conduct and assert their rights within the home, community, and movement. As the Zapatista captain Isabel describes, quote, "We gave women space to talk, express their feelings, and how they wanted to change all this. Life in the family, with their husband, with their children. That was where the ideas came from. If things are this bad, we ask ourselves, why not change it? Change men's ideas, as well as find a way, as an organization, to turn these ideas into a law. And that's how the Women's Revolutionary Law was born. Talking, venting, analyzing, it's not something from the outside. It came from our own ideas, our experience." End quote. The results have been dramatic, yet not complete. Women now increasingly defend themselves against abuse by men. Compañeras no longer fear denouncing attackers in the public, thereby facilitating collective resolution of conflicts with men. It is therefore not surprising that Subcomandante Marcos, as a spokesperson of the Zapatistas, regards the radical changes associated with the women's revolutionary laws as a revolution that makes revolution possible. But despite the Zapatista women's courageous opposition to patriarchy and sexual violence, oppressive gender practices persist. In 2004, Subramanian DeMarcus wrote an essay entitled Two Flaws, in which he concedes that the lack of women's equality and participation remains a major problem in the Zapatista movement. In the response to these problems, Zapatista women are forming a kind of counter-society to reduce the gap between the women's revolutionary laws and their everyday realities. They create various alternatives to sexist forms of government and conduct by learning to govern themselves and others differently. First of all, they work within the political structures to expand and support their own participation. Secondly, they initiate women's cooperatives to promote economic self-sufficiency, political education, local participation in assemblies, and finally, they organize regional women's encuentros, or assemblies, where hundreds of female representatives of Zapatista territories meet to share local knowledge and coordinate translocal projects. After concluding two theses from this work, I would then want to say that, in our view, firstly, the Zapatista movement's struggle for autonomy and Zapatista women's counterconduct demonstrate that other nonviolent resistance strategies are possible. And this goes against the conventional academic discourse on nonviolent strategies for popular resistance against oppressive states that has become vibrant and very fertile in the recent decade. After several decades in the margins, specialists now receive considerable attention in the mainstream media as well as in established social and political sciences. Prominent social movement scholars, for example, now recognize nonviolent resistance as a legitimate area of study and value efforts to bridge differences in research approaches. Nevertheless, we argue here that the field remains rooted in conventional premises and perspectives developed about 50 years ago. And these conventional premises and perspectives are state-centered and liberal reformist, not revolutionary. In our view, the Zapatista movement may be a bit contradictory as being an armed indigenous movement, is actually a promising example of another kind of nonviolent resistance strategy, oriented towards transformative struggles for dignity, autonomy, and counterconduct. While the Zapatistas retain their armed capacity out of necessity as a last resort, they do acknowledge and try to counter the risks of unwittingly nurturing violent behavior, roles, and values in their communities. This is evident, for example, in their ban of alcohol and focus on the emancipation of women. Thus, the Zapatista movement proposes another way of understanding and enacting nonviolence as a struggle to be without, against, and beyond violence. That resonates among subaltern revolutionaries around the world, from the Puerto Rican movement in El Barrio in New York to the Kurdish movement for a democratic society in Rojava. We see these movements as addressing sources and manifestations of violence that are deeply integrated in our societies, discourses, and lifestyles. As such, they carry the promise of transforming societies, subjectivity, social relationships, and the logic of states and capitalism. Finally then, the thesis 11, I jumped over some of the theses here to not be too long. The final thesis is that we are claiming that scholars have so far only studied nonviolent resistance within the world as it is. The point, however, is to make the world anew. As social and political scientists, we tend to see nonviolent activists and social movements as unconventional players within the established social political order. Using academic theories and methods, we categorize nonviolent resistance as successful when it removes authoritarian regimes or reforms liberal democratic regimes, and unsuccessful when it fails to do so. In either case, we normalize the world as it is, instead of envisioning the world as it might become. And we overlook the less visible transformation of social relationships, political subjectivities, and local institutions that allow the marginalized and dispossessed to reclaim dignity, autonomy, and initiative. We produce objective knowledge about the existing world of nonviolent resistance rather than engaging in intersubjective dialogue with resistors, constructing new worlds beyond violence. What is lacking, therefore, is research oriented toward the radical imagination of revolutionary subjects as well as researchers themselves. The radical imagination is the human capacity to refuse the assumption that there is no alternative to the logic of the colonial capitalist system and to insist that there are many ways to make the world anew. It fully recognizes the global forces of domination, undermining subjectivities and social relationships, yet affirms people's ability to be creative, constructive and cooperative, even in extremely violent areas like Chiapas. And it is a collective process rather than an individual possession, something that groups do together in and across local spaces. It is clear that transformative social movements, such as the Zapatistas, produce, practice, and inspire the radical imagination within and far beyond their own local communities. But how can academic researchers in universities that are integral to the colonial capitalist system enact and encourage the radical imagination? How can nonviolent resistance scholars contribute to the world as it might become? For one, we can share and validate the stories, experiences, theories and creations of courageous resistors around the world confronting multiple forms of violence. Instead of merely using academic language for objective analysis, we can use terms emerging from participating subjects, such as dignity and autonomy, and we can introduce terms with special relevance for their situations, such as counterconduct. Secondly, we need to rethink how nonviolent contention emerges from nonviolent construction, drawing on those non-mainstream, nonviolent action scholars that do acknowledge